Gentlemen, nice to see you here this evening for another one of our book talks, and nice to see some regular faces back again as well. A very special evening, I think. I think many of you already know the content, or some of the content, to this book. I think the title says it all. It's Timothy Beardsson's Stumbling Giant, The Threats to China's Future, where he poses the question that, well, perhaps it's not a guarantee that China is the next superpower to replace the United States, but don't let me take away his thunder. I know the book has been very well received and has had some very good reviews that I've been able to read online, so I'm sure we're in for a very interesting evening. We were extremely fortunate to have Professor Zhigang Tao from the Faculty of Business and Economics to be our moderator. He is the Associate Dean for Knowledge Exchange and China Development, and he's also the Director of the Hong Kong U Institute for China and Global Development. So I really don't think we could have picked a better person to be a moderator. So I'm going to hand it over to Professor Tao to introduce Mr. Beardsson.
Thank you. Good evening again. It's my great pleasure to introduce the speaker. Actually, I think you need very little introduction. Let me just make a few comments. You know, number one, it's not easy to be a very good businessman. You know, because we basically, you know, in Hong Kong, we teach business, and we know every year we train hundreds of graduates, and it's not easy to do business, especially in this part of the world. It's even harder to be a great thinker. You know, I think, you know, especially I like these interconnections between business. You know, doing business is one thing. Thinking about the problems behind those business and writing a book about China, that's much harder. If Paul Tan were here, I would say it's hard to be a doctor, but it's even harder to be a researcher on some of those problems you actually observe in treating the patients. So that's my first comment. The second comment is that it's very hard to be a contrarian. I think you are a contrarian. You know, to me, basically, you know, going to China in 1978, can you imagine what China really looked like in 1978? You know, we just had a little chat. You know, the tallest building in Shanghai was only 12 floors, right? It took less than 10 minutes from the airport to any part of the city because there was no traffic jam, right? There was no traffic jam. Right. So it takes great vision and also courage to be a contrarian. And I know in business, you can also make a lot of money by being a contrarian. You know, one thing I keep telling my daughters is that you make money by being a monopoly, and you make money by being on the other side. When everybody is selling, you should buy, and when everybody is buying, you should sell. But it's very hard to go against the trends. And I would say by 2013, virtually everyone is thinking about China being the giant and being the number one economy in the world. So it's the perfect timing to have a little bit dose of caution. And this is why we have this book, Stumbling Giant, and what are the problems China is facing. In fact, you know, if you read the book, it basically gives you a perfect diagnosis of all the problems China is faced with. And in fact, these are really the problems actually China really has to solve. If you really pay attention to, if you really keep following the news, China just released a report. A government think tank has just released a report talking about the reform strategy. They're talking about 3A3 reform plan. And I would say the reform plan is basically a set of solutions on those issues covered in the book by Tim. And so it's perfect timing to have this book talk. And I should actually stop here, and without any further delay, let's welcome the speaker.
Thank you very much indeed, Professor Tao. That was a very kind introduction. Can I just check that everyone can hear what I'm saying? Is it all? Okay. The rise of China has been, for 14 years, the most read subject on the internet and in the print media by a very large margin over any other subject in the world. But the literature, the books that have been published on the future of China, are surprisingly few. And those that there are tend to treat the subject pretty much as an economic subject and not really look more widely than that. And they also tend to be quite extreme. They have titles like When China Rules the World or The Coming Collapse of China. They're not what I'd regard as very thoughtful books. What I've endeavored to do in this book is to try and look at all the factors that determine the long-term future of a country. I've looked at education, I've looked at culture, I've looked at language, technology, as well as economics, history, politics, demography, social change. So I've tried to make an integrated look at what's likely to shape China's long-term future through this century. Sometimes when I'm introduced to give a talk, people will say, well, he's lived in Hong Kong and China for 35 years, and this book is the result of what he thinks. But I would say that's not really very accurate, because if I'd written a book immediately that I was asked to write it, it would have said quite a lot of very different things from what this book actually says. And that's because when I came to do the research that you need to do when you write a book, I found that the views that I thought were correct, I began to feel were not correct. I changed my opinions in quite a number of areas. I think if you live somewhere, it's very easy to slip into the conventional, easy views that everybody has about why things happen, why things are the way they are. And it's only when you actually have to think deeply about it, when you're required to really research it, that you start to question some of the views that you hold. And I certainly found I was doing that. So this isn't so much the result of what I thought over 35 years. It's partly the result of having thought quite deeply for 3 or 4 years. But yes, I've been lucky because since the 1970s, I've been fairly engaged in the opening up of China. I've been very privileged to be a practitioner, so I've been active in China's development. I had an investment banking business, and so I met with policymakers and discussed what they were trying to achieve and had the opportunity of talking deeply with a lot of very intelligent men about where they wanted China to go. And I learned a lot from that. So it's a combination of the privilege of discussing policy for decades, but also the fact that I did question my views and re-look at them, and sometimes I changed them. So it's what I'd call a combination. The book is about what could change China's current trajectory, which of course has been very rapid growth for 3 decades. What's likely to have any impact on that? What might change that? I've really looked at potential challenges, potential problems for China. I haven't spent much time on what's going well, because as it is, the book is over 500 pages. I don't think we want any more. I just focused on what could possibly affect China's current trend line. And so the book deals with negatives. It deals with problems, it deals with issues, it deals with challenges. I try to weigh them up, I try to analyze them, and I suggest what could be done about them, what policy prescriptions might be helpful for China to deal with the problems that I see coming towards China over the next few decades. Before I talk about the content of the book, there are three points that I'd just like to say go through the whole book. One point is that the data in China are always very frail. We mustn't put too much confidence in the statistics that we see. And we could say that about the world in general, but I think it's particularly true in China. And so when we read in the newspapers that traders are very excited today that Chinese GDP is 7.4, it's quite comic, because nobody knows if it's 0.4, and we don't really know whether it's 7. So we have to just stand back a little bit and just be quite cautious about all the data. We know that China's reported growth over 30 years of 10% a year on average. Well, it probably wasn't 10%, but we can clearly see from all the evidence that China has grown very rapidly. Whether it was 8%, 9%, 10 or 11, nobody really knows. And it's not that the government knows and we don't. Nobody knows, because the data available to the government are equally frail. So I would just say, let's not go into decimal places when we talk about China, and let's be just cautious about numbers in general. If we're lucky, the statistics will be illustrative of a general trend. If we're unlucky, they won't even be illustrative. I mean, if we look at unemployment data, it might be initially quite easy to assume that China's unemployment is 4%, and it is every month and is for years and years and years. But it doesn't take long to look at the data and realize that those figures are for people who live in certain areas, between certain ages, who've had a job before, who fulfill certain criteria. In other words, it's not the unemployment rate of China, which is substantially higher. So that figure isn't even illustrative of what's going on. So a general theme in the book is, let's be cautious about the data. The second thing is, people who speak about China or write about China will often say, oh, there are many, many cases of this bad situation, therefore China is in a bad way. But we have to put things all the time in context. If China has 4.5 times the population of America, then if there are 1,000 homicides in America, you'd expect there to be 4,500 in China. It's only interesting if there are 10,000 in China. Otherwise, there's nothing remarkable. People don't put things into proportion, they don't put things into context very often. And what I try and do in the book is to contextualize everything. Is it really a serious issue or is it not? Often people will say, but isn't there a lot of corruption in China? And I say, well, yes, there's a lot of corruption in China. In fact, there's a lot of murder in China. There are a lot of violin players in China. There's a lot of everything, because it's a big place. And all the time, proportion is so important, and we don't get proportion very often. And the third theme is that we hear a lot from people like Hillary Clinton or Condoleezza Rice about the reemergence of China. And in fact, Henry Kissinger wrote a book recently talking about the reemergence of China at the center of world affairs. But this is complete nonsense. I mean, China has never been at the center of world affairs, ever. I mean, it has had no influence over North and South America. It's had a few voyages to Africa in the 14th century, but it's left no legacy. It's had no influence over Europe. What we're seeing is the emergence of China for the first time on the world stage. And that's a really big story, and it's a very important story. But we shouldn't confuse it by talking about the re-emergence of China. So that's another theme I try to make in the book. So what I'd like to do, subject to the time that we've got, is to talk about some of the problems that I see China having and to mention other things that I've talked about. And then perhaps if we break and have a discussion and questions. I see quite a lot of large-scale problems coming. Some of them are already in the public domain and some have not really arisen yet. But the largest problem that I see is one that unfortunately there's no fix for, there's no solution for, and that's the problem of demography. Demography raises challenges in four different ways. I think it's widely known that China's workforce is in the process of peaking and going to go down. And of course, from most of the last 30 years, the workforce was growing rapidly, an abundance of young people were joining the workforce, and there was a period of 12 years where wages never changed. This helped to make China the most competitive place in the world to manufacture. That's terrific, but what we've seen since the early 70s is a fall in the number of births per year of 40%. So quite naturally, that's now coming through to entrance to the workforce. We're going to see a gradual reduction in the number of people in the workforce, and that's already having the effect of raising wages. We're now seeing wages rising at double figures. This makes China far less competitive in cheap manufacturing. And I would suggest that the economic model that has worked quite well for China up until recently now needs to be substantially changed to a different model. And there's a debate as to whether that should be a consumer-driven economy or maybe an innovation-driven economy. And I spend some time in the book saying why I don't believe that the consumer model is going to work anytime soon. And therefore, for me, the answer has to be the innovation-driven approach. Unfortunately, China shows very little sign at all of being successful at innovation. So for me, that is the first challenge, that demography requires China to change its model. But unfortunately, the levers are not being pressed in the right way to respond to that and come up with a successful alternative model. The second demographic challenge I see is again the result of features that are widely known, that China is an aging country. So at the moment, there are over 100 million people above the age of 65. But by 2030, there are going to be over 300 million people over 65. Now, that's one thing, that we're going to treble the elderly. But the nature of the Chinese family in mainland China is undergoing a substantial change as well. Because people are choosing to have fewer children, because medicine is making people live longer, although not necessarily healthily, but living longer, quite often people have got parents and even grandparents alive, but not siblings. And so the responsibilities of caring for the elderly are becoming more and more of a burden on those who are working. So the ratios of retired to working are changing. And this is going to continue. At the moment, 1.5% of the over 65s are in some kind of institutional care, being looked after by the state. 1.5%. Because virtually everybody is still in some way being looked after by families or by themselves. Given the changes to the nature of a Chinese family, I think that what we're going to be looking at by 2030 is not 1.5% needing institutional care, but possibly up to 50% of a trebled number, 300 million. In other words, we could be looking at the state not looking after a million people like today, but possibly up to 150 million people. And that has a very big budgetary impact in China. Because although China has the second biggest economy in the world, it has a surprisingly small budget for an economy of that size. In the United States, the budget at federal, state, and county level comes to approximately 40% of GDP. In Western Europe, the budgets are between 40 and 50% of GDP. In China, it's 22%. So it's in relationship to the economy, the budget is small. And I think by the time we get to the 2030s, there are going to be a lot of frictional debates about budget priorities. What can we spend our money on? What can we afford? Do we look after 150 million elderly? Or do we have six more aircraft carriers? There are strategic implications to this. So that's the second demographic challenge that I see. The third one stems from China's gender disparity. Because if people are going to decide to have fewer children, in a society like China, which has been predominantly rural, people have had a choice, a preference, to have male children. And they've quite often taken steps to ensure that that's the case. So over the last 20 years, we've had 6 boys born for every 5 girls. And 20 years is a long time. And based on that, not only does China have the most extreme gender disparity of any country in the world, but possibly of any country in history. And we can look forward and say that over the next 2 decades, we know that something between 45 and 50 million men are not going to get married. And this has a substantial social impact. It's like the population of France. And of course, it's not one man in six who's going to have a problem. Because as a sociologist will tell us, women play quite an important part in decisions to get married. And they tend to marry upwards, which means they marry more affluent men, they marry more intelligent men, maybe even better looking men. And so what it really means is that maybe 40% of the poorer, stupider, uglier men are not going to have a wife. They're going to be inarticulate, they're going to be angry, and they're going to be heading for the cities. And this is already beginning to have some effect on crime statistics in the larger Chinese cities, crimes committed by young, single males. This is likely to continue, become bigger, and probably have some effect eventually on social stability. So that's the third challenge I see. And the fourth one is what's happening to the overall population of the country. China's population is still slowly, very slowly growing. But the fertility rate, which basically is the number of children per couple, is, depending on whose data you look at, is between 1.45 and 1.7. So it's nowhere near the replacement rate, which would be 2.1. So you can make a projection as to what's going to happen to the population of China over the coming decades. And every single demographic forecast for China's future is that by the late 2020s, the population will peak at something like 1.4 billion and start to come down. And then we get some debate as to what happens next. The most cautious forecast is that of the United Nations, which tends to be very influenced by its member governments. And their forecast is that China will, by 2100, have a fall of approximately one-third in its population to about 950 million people. Every independent academic forecast is for much steeper falls, anywhere down to a fall of two-thirds in the population, bringing it down possibly even close to 500 million, which is an interesting number because that's roughly the forecast for the end of this century for the population of the United States. So at the moment, we're in a world where there are 4.5 Chinese citizens for every one American. On some forecasts, we could be looking at even approaching 1-to-1 by 2100. Now, various things come from this demographic outlook, but the first thing is that by the early 2020s, China will be overtaken by India to become the largest country in the world, the most populous country. That has an economic impact because at the moment, every multinational company has a strategy for China, how to invest, how to trade, how to sell things. But a lot of them have no strategy for India. Before we get to the early 2020s, they're mostly going to start to have a strategy for India. And that's likely to increase the amount of foreign capital flows into India, substantially increase. And it's likely to cause some small decrease in the flows into China. But I think the biggest result of what's going to happen to China's population is that I can think of no country in history which has had long-term substantial falls in its population decade after decade, and yet at the same time has been able to maintain sustained high rates of economic growth. You can have per capita growth, but for the total economy to grow when the total population is falling sharply has not been done so far. And it does bring us back to this point about China is going to need very much to move towards this innovation model to compensate for what's happening to the overall dynamics. If a lot of things go well for China, we might be saying in the 2030s, hasn't China done well this year? It's generated GDP growth of 2%. So from here to there, the likely trend line is going to be downwards. I'm sure with lots of ups and downs along the way, but we're showing 7-point-something growth at the moment. We're more likely to be looking at 3 or 2 or something like that by the late 2030s. And so I think what that suggests is that any of the big reforms that China needs to do, whether it's cleaning up the environment, changing the education system, rewriting the financial sector, require capital, they require finance. And it's going to be a lot easier to do that while the economy is growing at 7 or 6 than it is when the economy is growing at 4 or 3 or 2. So I would suggest that there's a window that China has to capitalize on where funding is available to do the things it really needs to do. But that requires a sense of urgency amongst policymakers. And although many of the issues in China are analyzed and commented on, they're not always approached and handled. So I think we need a greater sense of urgency by policymakers in China than we've really seen up until now. So that's the backdrop, because I would say that there is no quick fix to the demographic challenges. And usually at this point people say, well, surely the easy answer is we scrap the one-child policy. The problem is that the one-child policy has had no effect whatever on the annual rate of China's births. And I say that because it came in 1979, at which point China's rate of births had already fallen by 50%. China's rate of births has continued to fall since the laws came in, but pretty much exactly in line with the fall of birth rate in Korea, Taiwan, Hong Kong, and Singapore, which have no one-child policy. And what I would say is that the rate of births in China has been affected by the same things that have driven the birth rate in those other countries. Greater urbanization, people going from the rural areas to the cities, living in more expensive property, having fewer bedrooms, having fewer children. More women in the workforce, fewer children. People getting married later, having fewer children. And urbanization is the enemy of fertility globally. And there was a study just a couple of months ago about Ghana in Africa, that rapid urbanization is bringing down the fertility rate. It's a problem everywhere. But China's government would like to speed up urbanization. They probably haven't thought through the collateral impact of that socially. So I don't see that any of these trends are going to change quickly. So merely changing the one-child policy, I don't think is going to lead to any increase in China's rate of births. So that's the background. And then there are specific large-scale problems which can be dealt with, but they aren't always addressed. When President Hu and Prime Minister Wen Jiabao came to power, they said income inequality is unacceptable and needs to be addressed. Pollution is out of control and needs to be reduced. Corruption is very bad and needs to be handled. When they left, they made the same comments, and the situation in each case had got worse. It was analyzed, but it was not addressed. Now we have a new leadership which is making the same analysis, that these are unacceptable, they're not what China should find desirable. What we need to see, though, is policy action which will seriously address them. I mean, corrupt officials are arrested every year, but it doesn't deal with the issue. We need large-scale surgical approaches to the problems, whether it's the environment, whether it, all of these issues. I think China has a problem in getting from what it believes needs to be done to the actual implementation. often laws are passed, very good laws on the environment, on food safety, in all sorts of areas, but those laws are often simply not implemented. So there are issues of governance, which is not the same as what system of political government do we have in China. It's the issue of how government actually performs as a government. And the real question is over how China is performing in governance terms. And I think that really needs to be looked at. The issue I talked about earlier, innovation, the Chinese government has made this a priority for at least 15 years to make an innovation economy. I've said that I see very little sign of that being successful. Clearly, there are patches of excellence, supercomputers, 3D printing, genome work, low-cost space technology. But most of these are big projects, state-driven, with no immediate commercial applicability. The R&D that's needed to go through the commercial sector and make China an innovative business environment, that's not happening. 83% of the high-tech exports from China are made by foreign-funded companies, not by Chinese companies. They're just using Chinese labor. Why is China not being so successful? The targets that the government sets are quantitative targets. I would suggest they need to be more qualitative targets. For example, how many patent applications have we made this year? Well, we might say that the grants are more important than the applications. We might say that, well, what sort of patents? Are they invention patents or are they simply incremental improvements, what are called utility patents, where you take an existing thing and you make it marginally better? There are too many utility patents in China. And a lot of the patents which are won have very little commercial applicability. But people are getting bonuses based on the number of patents they apply for. The targets are often the wrong targets. If you look at research and development spending in China, too much of that spending is going on the buildings, it's going on the salaries, it's going on the trips overseas. It's not actually going on research. So spending doesn't mean much. It's what you do with the spending and what the results are of it. And I think in the scientific culture in China, there's too much hierarchy, too much deference. So the oldest scientist in the room is the person that everybody respects, the person who must be correct. And the youngest guy in the room, nobody really listens to. This is not a culture that's likely to get the best results. There's a problem of plagiarism in the academic world globally, that we've lost a prime minister of Romania, a president of Hungary, a defense minister of Germany, an education minister of Germany. We've lost a lot of prominent people in the West because of borrowing other people's PhD theses. But proportionately to that, the scale of plagiarism in Chinese academia is vast. And this doesn't create innovation. And I think if we look at the education system that leads to science and technology, the focus is on the amassing of data, the learning of facts, rather than the learning of critical skills, how to interpret, how to analyze, how to judge, how to discuss and debate. Those skills are not valued so much as learning data. But of course, the data are always changing. There's always new data coming. you can never learn all the data. I don't think this is a very productive system. But I think if you don't learn those critical skills, it's very difficult to foster innovation. And then when you consider that China has gone from 600,000 university graduates at the end of the 1990s to 7 million today, but in the last 8 years, China has built a new university every 3 days. It's not surprising that approximately 40 to 45% of Chinese graduates don't get a job. I mean, it has the highest graduate unemployment of any country in the world. It produces too many graduates, and it produces graduates without the skills that the economy wants. And it's understandable in a way, because politicians everywhere in the world do exactly the same thing. It makes them popular to say to their citizens, we will make your children university graduates. People like that. They love it. But as a result, we've got graduate unemployment in almost every country in the world. It's just at its most extreme in China per capita. China doesn't have one university in the top 100 in the world, but it has the second biggest economy. The whole education system, from primary to secondary education, is geared towards passing the university entrance exam, to which there is one correct answer to every question. You either learn it or you don't. But don't bother to think, that's not what you're asked to do. You're asked to remember the answers. So it produces a certain sort of student. And McKinsey did a survey a few years ago. They asked all the multinationals in China, what do you think about Chinese university graduates? And they said that, on average, 86% of them are not suitable to work in any international context. So I would suggest that China needs radically to overhaul its education system to create an innovation economy and to be competitive in the 21st century. But it won't be cheap, and it'll take a lot of time and a lot of thought. But it is at least achievable. Another challenge is the financial sector, which in the book I think I describe as dysfunctional. Here's an economy that's reported growth of 10% a year for 30 years, but the financial system is simply not. A well-organized part of that. If you consider that the private sector in China in 1980 was 3% of the economy and is now 67% roughly, you can say that if the economy grew at 10% a year, the private sector has grown at over 20% a year. But over 65% of bank loans go to the state sector, not to the private sector. And most of the balance go to local government or to foreign joint ventures. So there is virtually no access to the commercial banking market for private sector companies, which are now well over half the economy. This simply isn't the way to run an economy. The private sector companies either have to limit their growth to what they can generate in annual profitability, or they have to go into the shadow or the unofficial banking market and borrow at generally extremely high interest rates. And even those who get access to the state banks for credit are paying a different rate to the state sector. So the whole system is inefficiently geared to trying to maximize China's potential to grow. Another example is that the well-publicized growth that China's reported since the 70s has caused a lot of investors around the world to say, I'd like to invest in this very fast-growing economy. And they've looked at the Chinese stock market and they've bought shares and they've bought mutual funds. And they're a little bit surprised that this week, for example, the Chinese stock market index is roughly where it was 12 years ago. It simply has no bearing on what the economy is doing. And they're quite baffled. They don't understand why. But one answer is very clear, that something like 85% of the entire value of the Chinese stock market is state sector companies, because access to the markets is controlled by the authorities, and private companies have been discouraged from listing on the stock market, and state companies have been encouraged. And so you have a stock market which doesn't reflect the economy. So we shouldn't expect the stock market to do what the economy is doing. But again, to not allow your fastest growing companies to access capital markets is rather like taking out a pistol and shooting yourself in the foot. It's not very efficient. Maybe a third aspect of dysfunctionality in the financial markets in China is the whole question of foreign exchange reserves. People are very excited that China has $3.5 trillion of foreign exchange reserves. Surely China could go and buy Citibank or rescue the Western financial system. It tends to overlook the issue of how you create foreign exchange reserves. Now, obviously, the immediate way of creating them is fairly obvious. You're either intervening in the foreign exchange markets every day to stabilize your currency. So you sell yuan and you buy dollars or euros or something, and you try and stabilize rates. So at the end of the year, you've accumulated foreign exchange. And the other way is you have companies that export more than they import, and therefore at the end of the year, they accumulate foreign exchange, which they have to sell to the authorities in exchange for local currency. So it's not surprising that the authorities accumulate a lot of foreign exchange, but they had to buy it. And where did they get the money to buy $3.5 trillion worth of foreign exchange? They've spent $3.5 trillion equivalent in their currency, and they didn't just go out and print it. Largely, that resource has been found through two mechanisms. One is the issuance of bonds to Chinese insurance companies, Chinese banks. That has raised domestic currency for the authorities. The other source has been asking the entire banking system to place reserves with the central bank in proportion to the size of their balance sheets, like many other countries do. But those have been the two principal sources of domestic currency, which have then largely funded the purchase of overseas assets. But I would suggest that if you have something like $3.6 trillion of foreign assets, and maybe something like $3 trillion of domestic currency liabilities, this is not a very enviable position. It's not a very strong position to be in. It's actually a rather vulnerable position to be in, because if the Chinese currency goes up substantially, if it goes up 10%, you lose $360 billion on your foreign assets. The yield that people are receiving from the Chinese government on their domestic bonds is significantly more than the Chinese government is receiving on its foreign assets. And you imagine what US Treasuries are yielding at the moment. there's been an estimate that the Chinese government is losing something like $66 billion a year on the difference in interest rates. So these foreign exchange assets are not available to go out and make some long-term big purchase because they're matched by almost similar levels of debt. If you want to be colourful in language, you could say that perhaps China looks a little bit like the largest undiversified, highly leveraged currency hedge fund in the world. I mean, I don't think that's the way the Chinese government sees itself, but the impact is rather similar. So I would suggest that that situation can't continue for a long time to come. It will at some point need to be unwound. It's a source of potential danger to China, not a source of strength. And in a way, it's not dissimilar from what the United States is doing with its policy of quantitative easing, where the US government is buying its own debt on borrowed money, or money that's simply created. And oddly enough, the size of US debt that is held by the US government is $3.6 trillion. And that will have to be unwound. And nobody knows the damage that will be caused in the unwinding of that situation, in the same way that we don't really know what the collateral damage will be when China has to get out of these foreign exchange assets and repay its domestic debt. But when you consider that a lot of the reforms that are being discussed, and Professor Tao alluded to this earlier, the discussion at the moment of reforms in China includes reforming of interest rates, which are held artificially low. But of course, if interest rates were allowed to pick up, it would have a lot of positive benefits. It would reduce unnecessary capital investment. It would encourage domestic savers to feel more affluent and possibly spend a little bit more. But the victim of liberalizing interest rates is the government, which has so much domestic debt, which is already losing money on. So it's difficult for them to liberalize interest rates in the same way that it's difficult for the United States to allow interest rates to come up. Because if we had normal interest rates in America, it's doubtful whether Washington would be able to pay the interest on federal debt at 5%. That's the principal reason why interest rates are being held so low. Nothing to do with jobs or GDP, where clearly it has no effect at all. So those are some of the problems which can be addressed, need to be addressed. Obviously, the environment is another whole issue which can be cleaned up, it can be addressed, but it will require money. So I deal in the book with what I feel are the problems China has, what the answers should be to those problems. I talk about the relationship with neighboring countries, China's engagement with the world as a whole. I talk about cyber hostility, areas where China might need to reflect whether some of its actions might cause it to become quite unpopular. And if that were to be the case, does that mean the countries would try to slow China's rise because they don't particularly like China? And to what extent does China really reflect on the way it looks? So I talk a little bit about China in the world. I talk about social change. I talk about the future of the Communist Party, whether it's going to be able to continue in power. And I suggest that if the party is able to show the adaptability that it did in the 80s and 90s, again, if it's able to see the problems, address the problems quickly, to reform effectively as it has done before, it could well be in power for decades to come. But we've now had 13 years of essentially no reform since 2000. And the question is whether the party is going to be able to again get back to reforming. I mean, the 80s and the 90s, China was the fastest reforming country in the world. Highly impressive, achieved a lot. There's a real question over whether they're going to be able to do it or not, because so many people have to be convinced. I mean, China is not a dictatorship. President Xi, Li Keqiang have to persuade a lot of people to agree to these reforms. It's not clear whether everybody will agree to them, so it's very interesting to see what happens the next year or two. Anyway, those are some things I talk about in the book, and I'm very happy to discuss anything. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Tim, for your really wonderful summary of your book. You know, those are the problems. Some of these problems are really beyond control, really difficult to solve, and others are relatively easy to solve. And before we take questions, you know, I'd like to make a few comments. Number one, you know, in the last 35 years, China was really in the first phase of economic development, where the competitive advantage was really in low-cost production. So when you have abundant supply of labor, when you don't really face very high cost of polluting the environment, the easiest way of making money is just low-cost production. So there was literally no need for technological upgrading. So there is always this silver lining to the problem that China is going to face. That is the demographics. You know, the very first thing you actually mentioned. You know, if we are going to have declining labor force, which means wage rate will increase, which means cheap production is not going to be the future, and that will actually lead to demand for innovative activities. So there could be market reactions to those problems which are really beyond the control of the government. Now, on your other point, you know, because I think Tim talked about these really strange arrangement, you know, this allocation of capital, because we just talk about demographics, which is labor. The other input for production is capital. And the way China does it is that you have these state monopoly taking deposits from citizens and give them really low interest rates, and then lend money to state-owned enterprises at relatively low interest rates. If there's any money left, as you say, they give to the government, or they lend to the private enterprises, which is really the driver of the economy. Now, the way I think about this is that in China, the SOEs, the state-owned enterprises, they are the real kids. You know, these are the biological kids. And private enterprises, these are the adopted kids. And the adopted kids give you growth. Your own kids, you know, they give you social stability. You know, let's say a few months ago, when college graduates had difficulty finding jobs, SOEs received orders from the government saying that you have to hire more graduates. Now, private enterprises wouldn't do that. So in other words, China is very much like McDonald's. You have company-owned units, you also have franchise units. And this is how we look at, you know, when they want to have economic growth, they give a little bit more freedom to the private enterprises. But when they face financial crisis, they tend to spend money. And when the government spends money, of course, they spend money on state-owned enterprises. Now I think, you know, with these comments, we are open to questions from the floor. Yeah.
Does anyone have any questions? Please raise your hand. Pass you the mic.
Thank you for a very good speech and presentation. I agree with a lot of your viewpoints. But just have one clarifying question, first of all. I believe you mentioned that China has no university in the top 100. Is that correct?
That's, obviously there are three surveys of universities globally. The one I feel is probably the fairest one to use is the only one which is produced inside China. It's produced by Shanghai Jiao Tong University, because they place no university in China in the top 100, including themselves. So I think that's a fairly honest and blunt appraisal.
I think it comes down to sources then, because I just noticed that according to the QS ranking, which is the one HKU tends to use for itself, there are two universities in China in the top 50.
I think the Shanghai Jiao Tong one use relatively more scientific data. They actually look the citations a little bit more. I actually agree with Tim's assessment. Basically, in China, in whatever industries which are protected by the government, then you tend to have inefficiency. Educational sector is one of the last few sectors which is still protected. If you want to have any educational business in China, you have to have a joint venture. This is the case for New York NYU. This is the case for Duke University. So in protected industries, you tend to have inefficiency. But on the other hand, I don't really worry about that, because this is a today's world is a flat world. You know, we know that the Chinese families, as they become richer and richer, they send their kids to the United States to study. They send lots of kids to Hong Kong U to study, where you do have proper training, you do receive proper training, and later on they can actually move back to China to start businesses.
Professor, I think I agree with many of your, but of course without the benefit of reading your book, you know, I have to make some, you know, just maybe uninformed or, you know, comments, you know, but I agree with many of your analysis and your prognosis, you know, but I'm not sure I agree with some of your conclusions. I would focus first of all on the population. You mentioned that even if China now reintroduces the or abolishes the one-child policy, it isn't going to make much of an impact. I tend to be skeptical of your judgment, you know, because China, you compare China to Korea, you know, Japan or Taiwan, so but I think they're not really that comparable by virtue of the fact that China is such a big. It's still a very big agricultural country, and many people on the countryside. The latest figure is urbanization has risen to over 50%, but still, the other 50% lives on the countryside. So, if China begins to liberalize the population policy, actually, there is now, I think there's some signs or indications or rumors that Shanghai would be the first to do it as a guinea pig and so on, or maybe it's already doing it in some way or form. Now, once this goes to the countryside, spreads to the countryside, I think the impact will still be pretty big, because the countryside, the rural people are much more conservative, right, than the urban people. So despite all the problems, well-known problems you mentioned about people, about urbanized people want having lower fertility, I think the same cannot be said of the countryside. When you're talking about 600 million, 700 million people, well, the impact on the fertility rate, you know, will be pretty big, you know. So I guess I would not disagree that India will become the most populous country. Let them do it, you know. I mean, but China, even being the second most populous country, I doubt it will drop by the percentage you mentioned to 500 million and that sort of thing. I think that's really a bit over the top, you know, if I may say so, you know. So I'll leave it there for the time being. Actually, I've got a few other questions, but I'll leave the others to have the chance. You know, thank you.
In that case, let me address some aspects of what you said. First of all, China's birth rate fell by 50% before the one-child policy was brought in. That's a big fall. Secondly, Thailand has fallen fairly similarly to China, and Thailand has a big rural population. I agree that Singapore and Hong Kong are fairly urban, so Thailand's interesting, and there are quite a lot of farmers in Korea. Also, I mentioned Ghana. I mean, Ghana has a lot of rural people, and Ghana's fertility rate is coming down largely because of urbanization. So I don't think that I can take the view that just scrapping this law is going to change the dynamics of what's happening in China. And when you say that you don't agree with the likely population trends the rest of this century, I should reiterate that none of the forecasts are mine. They are the only forecasts there are by anybody anywhere. I simply looked at every demographic forecast I could find. Now, everybody agrees in peaking in the late 2020s and starting to fall. But after that, there is a debate. The debate is how far it's going to fall. But the lowest forecast is the United Nations. Every other forecast is for a much steeper fall. You can say you agree with the United Nations, or you can say you agree with somebody else. But if you say you don't agree with any of them, you've got to find some evidence for having a different point of view. Because I can't find anybody who's got a different point of view. Everybody I've found in this field, every professional demographer, is looking for a significant fall in China's population. I'm not a demographer. I can't really find the substance to disagree radically with every single one of them. I've got to assume that somewhere between one-third and two-thirds fall is what's going to happen.
My comment is that basically you have three types of people in China. You know, you have the middle class. They're really facing rising cost of educating the kids, you know, so the impact on their fertility rate is going to be more or less in line with what Tim says. For people in the rural area, yes, you know, they like to have more kids. They are already having more kids, you know, so the impact is going to be limited. But those rich people, actually, you know, if you just look at the number of men and Chinese who want to come to Hong Kong to have kids, so the demand is there, and there will be impact on fertility rate. Now, my second point is that number is not the most important thing. It's the quality of human capital. You know, as I said earlier, the first stage is about low-cost production, but the second stage is precisely about doing something truly innovative, and you do innovative things because your labor cost is high. You have to innovate. And you know, one example I always use is that 35 years ago, we had a lot more farmers, we had a lot more land, but we didn't have enough food to eat. So it's not just number, it's not just quality, it's the incentive that people have for production. So you might have a smaller worker force, but so long as they're very well educated, so long as they're incentivized, they can produce things that you like to have.
A small follow-on question, which might also be relevant, is that because of the number of exceptions which have now sprung up across China, if you lost a child in the Sichuan earthquake, you can try again. If you're in certain rural provinces, you can have two children. If you've only got a girl, you can have two children in case you have a boy. So there are a lot of exceptions. And of course, the ethnic minorities have always been exempt. So it's estimated that the number of people who are exempt from the one-child policy is now quite big. The forecast is that approximately 38% of Chinese are still governed by the one-child policy. So that's another perhaps relevant factor.
Actually, I got two questions. The first one is, I heard that you got some changes of your views on when you wrote your book. Can I have like one or two examples, like why you changed your view on that specific topic, and what triggered the change? And secondly, in light of like so many internal issues that China is suffering from, is China like creating a problem or an advantage spending so much on military? I mean, it might give it's giving impression like others are perceiving this kind of like rapid growth in military expenses a threat. Is it a problem or an advantage due to like so many territorial disputes?
Okay. I think the best example of the first point is the very discussion we're having here. I mean, I had always assumed that the one-child policy was the reason for China's fall in births. It seemed that was the purpose of the policy, that's been the result, and therefore, presumably, the policy caused the fall. It seemed fairly logical without really thinking about it. And it was only when I started to research that I realized that it wasn't the policy that had caused the fall. But that meant researching a lot of the academic work on the subject, looking into demography in China and also in the general world. I realized that I'd slipped into a convenient, easy assumption that wasn't actually correct. And it's very easy to do that. On military spending, I think China gets a very bad rap for its military spending. And the Americans are always saying, China shouldn't be growing its military spending so much. It spends far more than it needs to do. This is very bad. And China doesn't even report everything that it spends. Well, China reports that it spends 2% of GDP on military spending. Independent projections are that it really probably spends 2.5% of GDP on the military, which happens to be exactly what the average country does worldwide. So I really can't see why China should be criticized for spending 2.5% of its GDP on military expenditure if that's what the average is for every other country in the world. America spends virtually 6%. Why should America criticize China? I don't understand. So I feel some of this debate is really just wrong and rather hostile and unnecessarily so. Okay, China's economy has been growing at a rapid rate, and therefore the spending every year has been growing because they've kept it to a certain percentage. That's fine. It seems not entirely unreasonable. What concerns me more is that Asia is the fastest arming continent in the world. Most military budgets in Asia are in the process of doubling or more. At the same time, the rhetoric between countries is becoming increasingly harsh and hostile. Not just China to its neighbors, but you could argue that Japan towards China, that there is a danger that we're going to get into a situation where something goes wrong and politicians will find it difficult to step back and disengage from all the harsh rhetoric. And if they stoke up public anger at neighboring countries, it could just be difficult to avoid following through. So could get into a situation like in 1912, 13, 14, before the First World War, when arguably nobody wanted to go to war, but nobody would actually stand back and stop. And that's a situation we don't want to get into. And Asia's looking increasingly difficult and dangerous at the moment.
Observation is the birth rate had already like fallen before the policy. So why did the government did so stupid thing?
Because they wanted it to fall more. It had fallen by 50%, but they wanted it to fall further.
Why did it fall by 50%? That was kind of new to me.
Well, why did it fall? I suppose, again, you could probably argue that there was a degree of modernization in China. I think it took France 100 years to go from 5 births to 2 births per family, and China did it in something extraordinarily short. I can't remember what it was. But these are trends all over the world, at different speeds towards smaller families. You're even seeing it in Africa, that the demography is starting to fall. But Africa's still growing quite fast. But these are global trends. And we're not going to see anything like 15 billion people in the world at the end of the century. We may not see 10. I think global population forecasts are probably going to have to be brought down.
Mm-hmm. On the second question raised by the lady, I would say it's not military expenditure of China that the American worries the most. It's the growing influence, is the amount of foreign aid China gives to Africa, to other parts of Asia. You know, unlike some of these European countries that what they did, you know, many years ago, China starts to build roads, build sports stadiums, you know, in Africa. So that actually gives China growing influence, and I think that's the thing that American worries the most.
Well, I think you're absolutely right that they shouldn't be worried about the spending. What I think they probably worry about is what the military is going to be used for, and that's not what they want to say, so they argue about the spending. But there's nothing really to criticize. But I think what China is doing in Africa is very interesting. It's a different model. It's not so much charitable. It's commercial. It's investing. It's doing business. And I think Africans prefer the Chinese model. I think they'd rather be treated as an adult and have someone do business with them than give them a check. Now, I think China's approach has been reasonably popular in Africa. We can criticize some aspects of it. I mean, Chinese managers are not always used to having a strike and tend to rush to the rifle. Maybe that's a bit old-fashioned. Obviously, some of China's projects have been done on the cheap. Some of the roads have collapsed. The general hospital in Angola has fallen down after 2 years. But overall, I think China's contribution to Africa has been overall positive. It's been a good contribution. I mean, we can question the fact that China generally doesn't like using African contractors. It doesn't like using African labor. It prefers to bring in Chinese suppliers and Chinese labor. And why is Chinese labor cheaper than African labor? Well, the principal reason why it is cheaper is that a lot of it is convict labor from Chinese prisons.
I want to raise one point regarding the African, like Chinese aid in Africa. I really doubt whether it's like solely or mainly economic. If that's the case, why China export Confucius idea to those countries?
Well, China wants to persuade people.
That's influence. Not economic.
China wants to persuade people to learn Chinese and to be sympathetic to China. That's the purpose of the Confucius Institutes. The trouble is they're not very successful. I mean, if you listen to the Confucius Institutes, they've been saying since 2000 that 40 million people in the world are learning Chinese. By 2010, it's going to be 100 million, and it's the fastest growing language in the world. Well, every one of those three statements is wrong. There were never 40 million people learning Chinese. It's not the fastest growing language in the world, and there were never 100 million people by 2010 learning Chinese. But these statements were reiterated over and over again by the Confucius Institute that probably doesn't bother to add up the numbers.
Thank you, Mr. Pearson, for an excellent speech. And my question also concerned with the demography. So you mentioned that the wages increasing in the coastal area, especially because the shortage of labor due to the demographic structure has, you know, the shortage of population, labor population there. But there's other, I think there's other channel for the wage increase in this coastal area. For example, inflation, because the wage maybe is due to the living cost in this coastal area is increasing, and that the labor is thinking about they cannot save money in this coastal area, and they rather go back to their homeland, which they can actually start their own business, which can save more money if they just immigrate to these coastal areas. And so I think there will be, you know, two channels for the wage to explain the wage increase. One is your supply-driven explanation, and also the inflation-driven explanation. And the reason I think, in my opinion, maybe it's because inflation-driven, because actually, last year I read a report by JP Morgan, and it's a very interesting report. It compared China, because the aging problem that China's facing, so it compared with the situation in Japan in 1980s. And in the report, they compared the proportion of non-agricultural employment of the total employment. And in China, it's 60% of the population is non-agriculture, and in Japan in 1980s, it's about, if I am right, it's 90%. So it seemed to me that there's still some, you know, agriculture labor can be transferred to the non-agriculture industry. And also, I think that the demographic issue is not the 100% Achilles heel for China development, because just last day, China announced that they have already achieved this year's employment target. It's about 9 million people, 9 million new employment. And the reason that China has achieved this target earlier, 3 months earlier, is because there's less new employment demand. And just also, and most of the demand are observed by the service industry, because most of the time they need to observe by the manufacturing industry. But this time, because the the decrease of the labor demand and the increase of service industry, so it can be achieved earlier. And the comments is there is that it give China because the ultimate things that the government care about is not the GDP growth, it's how much new employment can be solved, because it's directly related to the stability. So how the labor can be absorbed, new labor can be solved, the market is what common concern. So I think that so my opinion is that the shortage, the decreasing labor demand has actually given the government a chance to upgrading their manufacturing sector and let the service industry to absorb the labor demand. So I think whether you have a comment on that.
Well, it's quite an extended question. Maybe I just make 2 points. Yeah, there is still a lot of underemployed rural population, but the difficulty is that what the factories want is generally, in an ideal world, women, and preferably under 25. What they don't want is men over 40. So a large part of the rural population are not really wanted for factory work. They're not so adaptable, they can't adjust so easily. So although there are several hundred million people there who are surplus to requirements in the agricultural field, they're not really what's wanted by the factories on the coast. This is a social problem. A second aspect is China has both shortage of labor and unemployment at the same time, because the population isn't fungible. A person isn't the same as another person. So the kind of people want aren't necessarily the kind of people who are out of a job and available for employment. And it's partly a question of what the education system is providing in the way of skill sets. But you also make a good point, which is that in the long term, for China to change its economic model is good, not bad, to cease to be a low-cost manufacturer, making products for other people to sell under their brand name, for them to get the profit margin, is not ideal for China. It's better for China to develop its own brands, to own its own profit margin. And of course, that's the way to go. The question is how to get there. But Singapore tried this in the 1980s by letting its currency deliberately go up to force manufacturers to get out of low-cost activities and get into higher-margin activities. But it's not always that easy to achieve. But if China can make that move eventually, it'll be very healthy for China. Because one of the reasons why the budget of China is so small is that China has extensive exports at razor-thin margins. So there's very little to tax, and therefore very little to spend on welfare provision or whatever else you want to do. We need China's economy to be operating on higher margins. We need China to develop brands and to be the owner of what it produces rather than a subcontractor. So all of this is healthy in the long term if it can be achieved.
Basically, what you will see in China in the next 20 years is that you have these two different models of economic development at the same time. For the coastal area, it's going to be more about service economy. It's going to be more about China as a market, because as people in the coastal area become more affluent, they will have more spending power. So you will see more and more multinational companies going to Shanghai just for focusing on the local market. And meanwhile, in the interior part of China, you will still have a lot of surplus labor, right? And that's where they hope to maintain the low-cost production mode. So they want to have this dual approach to have this smooth transition towards the final goal. Of course, it's all about service economy. It's all about your own brands, you know, your own very high margins. Yes.
Good evening. If we look at how innovation develops in many, usually in many, wherever in the world, you see like soft or light networks between many persons who deals in the same areas. So that's what happened in the Silicon Valley or in the north of Italy regarding design. So this very soft networks of people in the same industry, and also this curiosity or entrepreneurship of individuals with different mindsets. And as in China, there is this culture, or the state in a certain fashion has eroded these soft connections amongst people in order to amass more political power. And also maybe the education system is not geared towards this kind of more independent thinking. Maybe this could be obstacles to innovation. So what do you think about these considerations, and if you agree, what would be the ways to overcome these obstacles?
Well, one of the things that we've seen is the development of clusters in China around manufacturing bases, where people making objects have attracted subcontractors to them to supply objects. And we've seen process innovation. We've seen these companies become better and better at what they do, but they haven't necessarily become innovative, but they have become better at processing their work, more efficient. And they've had to be, because it's been a very competitive world, and they've been able to increase their sales despite the fact that their currency has been going up since 2005. So Chinese companies have been very adaptable, very competitive, very successful at innovating their processes, but they don't seem to have been able to innovate product. That's been the problem. That's what's really missing.
Well, what you really need is the kind of institutional environment in which people respect property rights, respect intellectual property rights. And so this is actually the role of Hong Kong. Actually, when China first opened up, they got special economic zones. You know, these are the zones in which you simply import institutions from more advanced economies. So I think, you know, that's one thing. So China, what China needs to do is to have institutional reform. I think this is coming. The second thing is more about the point that I made earlier, that is, as labor cost goes up, there will be demand for automation, there will be demand for innovation, because so far China is kind of far away from technological frontier, so the easiest strategy is just to copy other people's technology. But as you get closer and closer to the frontier, it's not going to be easy to copy anymore. So they have to innovate. So that's the kind of the push side.
Yeah, I mean, for example, America is always criticizing China for intellectual property theft. But we should never forget that what built the American economy in the 19th century was the theft of intellectual property from Europe. And America likes to forget that today. So all of these things can change, can develop. We just need to see the building blocks put in place to make that quantum leap to the next stage.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Bitson. Thank you for a very insightful talk and very knowledgeable about China. My question is about stability and human rights. You mentioned about the need for stability. Well, at least, you know, that's what the ruling sort of elite expects from such a big country. With all the different changes in China, with land grabs, you know, for development, you know, people who need to protest, you know, the lack of rule of law, maybe, you know, corrupt officials. What is your view about where human rights will be going? You know, is there going to be more clamping down on dissent in China? Will there be, you know, greater transparency in China? Will there be better rule of law? Will there be more institutions like an independent judiciary? You know, where is China going in terms of how it balances the need to feed its masses, but also to have the freedom of speech, for example? Thank you.
Well, the number of mass incidents, or what we might call violent riots, has been steadily growing over the years. The last estimate from Tsinghua University was in 2010, but it had got up to 180,000 a year, which is basically 500 a day. I mean, it's huge numbers. But the reasons for them are almost always the same. Some officials take land from farmers, give them low compensation, sell it to developers. Or perhaps pollution, children die, there's battery factories polluting the river or something like that. And then occasionally there are other things, but it's usually around that. And what the party has been quite successful at doing is differentiating between national leadership and events on the ground. And if you look at any surveys of Chinese public opinion, the opinion of local officials is generally quite low. And the higher you go up, the higher the opinions people have. Surveys of, is the country going in the right direction, normally get something like 85% yes. And there's no other country in the world that approaches that. I mean, I think Australia once got 60%, but I mean, most of the major Western countries score less than 50%. And these are surveys by Western institutions in China. People are able to differentiate somehow, almost as if the leaders in Beijing don't really understand what's going on. I'm sure they'd be very unhappy if they knew what was going on in my city. But our officials are terrible. But the leadership is doing the right thing and it's going in the right direction. And that's quite clear in all the surveys, that people make a big difference. I don't think there's a huge call in China to change the political system. But I think there is an increasing call for better government, better implementation of existing policies, and to bring in new good policies. But I think that if the party were able to address those demands, it could well continue to stay in power.
Thank you. Thank you. Well, towards the end of your talk, you were asking whether the party will continue to be adaptive, whether it could reintroduce the reform program. And in the introduction, Professor alluded to this upcoming party congress, that this reform program will be introduced and is said to be unprecedented. What do you expect, or what could we expect of the upcoming reform?
Well, I think when Mr. Yu says that the reforms upcoming will be unprecedented, he's bound to be 100% right, because by definition, a reform is something that hasn't happened before. I'm not holding my breath. The question is, what will these unprecedented reforms be? Will they be able to liberalize interest rates? Clearly not across the board, because the government couldn't afford to pay those interest rates on its debt. So maybe some interest rates will be liberalized and probably others will not. There be an opening of bank credit to the private sector? I don't know. There's so much vested interest against reforms. And of course, because China perhaps has the disadvantage of not being a dictatorship, so many people have to be consulted. Many of those people have an economic interest in the way things are today. But it may just prove very difficult for Mr. Li or President Xi to make the reforms that they may wish to make. Because so much effort has been put in China since the 70s to make sure that never again will there be one arbitrary leader of China who can just change everything. Because people suffered so much in the Cultural Revolution, they never want that again. And so the whole process, a matrix of collective leadership has been painfully put in place, but people just can't make quick changes on their own volition. And I don't know whether President Xi would be able to bring in a lot of very meaningful reforms very quickly. Also, I think when we come back to this question of human rights, but I think what we're seeing in these early days of the new leadership is that perhaps there's some sort of understanding that we'll have some economic reforms, but the price will be that we'll tighten up on expression and freedom of speech and that sort of thing, so that perhaps President Xi looks like a tough leader, not like a Gorbachev, because that's the thing that nobody wants to be seen as in China. Nobody wants to be Gorbachev. So maybe President Xi's analysis is, I can get some reforms through the system, providing I look like a really tough guy. And maybe what we're seeing is a lot of toughness in the human rights area. Mm-hmm. That's the price of modest reforms.
Well, I think if you read the latest reform plan, it's very interesting. You know, they actually set out three objectives and three ways of achieving it. The three objectives: number one, reducing the role of government in the economy, because that's the crux of the problem. Why you have corruption is because government is so powerful. Government is always involved. You always have to ask for permission from the government. Number two, enhancing the role of market. Number three, they want to unleash the innovative spirit of the enterprises. And the way to move forward, basically, they want to provide social safety net, introducing competition. And the whole idea of free trade zone in Shanghai is about using external forces, using international competition to force those vested interest parties in China to reform. So as Tim said earlier, previous reform in China was relatively easy because we didn't have any options. So it was reform without losers. From now onward, any reform, somebody's interest will be affected. So it's really about the party's long-term interest. I think the party is really paranoid. The party is really worried about its own control. So this is why the party may have the courage, you know,
this is precisely the point you made earlier, that is, Xi is consolidating his political authority, whereas Li is basically working on a plan which is very pro-market. So I'm actually very, I'm cautiously optimistic. Yeah. Yeah, I think okay. Let's take just the last question. This is the last question.
Okay, thank you very much. Professor, thank you. I'm personally very interested in one point that you have mentioned in your lecture, and which is about the issue of governance in China. I think the concept of governance, I think, is a neutral point. I think the Chinese government will also be very interested to hear your ideas. My question is that, what do you mean by, how do you judge the governance issue in China? Do you mean the effectiveness of the government, the implementation of policies, and also what do you think the issues come from? What can be done? Yes.
Sure.
Thank you.
There's a big difference between what form of government a country has, whether it's a democracy or a monarchy or a presidential system, and whether it governs well. For me, these are completely different questions. I mean, somewhere like Bahrain can be governed well, but it has no democracy. For China to have good governance means that the leadership needs to identify the issues that need resolution. It needs to resolve them efficiently. And that might be cleaning up the environment. That might be to overhaul the education system. It might be to support innovation, to create this transition to a better economic model. All of these things are very important, and the government can do them. And it doesn't need to change its political system in China. But what we're not getting at the moment is good governance. And I think there are issues over how cadres are managed in China. I think the system is not working optimally. The theoretical method of managing officials is this management by objectives. You have to grow GDP, avoid riots, avoid unemployment, keep the environment clean. Well, these guys are suffering target fatigue. Too many targets, all at the same time, often looking contradictory. People find it really hard. The one that's easiest to dump is the environment one, because it doesn't seem to fit with the other ones. So it's human nature, you can understand. But we've got to find a better way to manage and motivate the officials. And this really comes down to the organization department of the Communist Party. That's their job, to appoint people, to manage them, to evaluate them, and to either promote them or discard them. And not only does the target system not work at the moment, of course, it's affected by all the personal relationships that get in the way. So if somebody has a powerful friend, even if he's not very good, he might get promoted. So you get these complications. So there's a lot of institutional difficulty in the way things are working at the moment. And the party really has to consider how it improves governance. Because if it can deliver, it can stay. But if it fails to deliver, it'll probably go.
Okay, I think that's about enough. I know we could go on for some time, but please join me in thanking Matthew Bidson for his exceptional and insightful presentation and some wonderfully robust discussion. And equally thank our exceptional moderator, Professor Tao, this evening.
Thank
I have
you
a small,
very much
a small souvenir for each of you.
Thank you very much
this
indeed.
This is reportedly a reproduction of one of the first books ever produced in Hong Kong from our rare book
Fantastic.
Room.
Thank you. Terrific.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen.
So one final advertisement. We have our next book talk, a special book talk on Saturday, the 23rd. Very rare that we do one on a Saturday. Saturday the 23rd of November. It's Dr. Vivian Poi. She's the former senator for Toronto, Canada. And she will be here talking about her new book, which is called Passage to... Oh, it escapes me now. Passage to... Pilgrimage, yes, something. I can tell you if I've got it written here. Passage to Promised Land, Voices of Chinese Immigrant Women, so something thereabouts. So she'll be talking about that, and there'll be some other special guests speaking here, including Elizabeth Sin and one or two others. So hopefully we'll see you there. I think it's at 4 o'clock and probably in this location, but you'll all get an email, I'm sure. So thanks again, and please once again, thank our speakers.